As we come to this place to worship God, I invite us to join in a greeting that we will give to each other in a response, and then remain standing while we sing our first song, Light of the World. Please stand with me. All right. Grace to you and peace from God, our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the name of the Lord our God. For us and for our salvation, Christ has become obedient to death, even death on a cross. Light of the world, here I am to worship. Let us go to God in prayer. Let us pray together. We are yours, all yours, blessed triune God. All of our lives, all of our thanks, all of our praise, all of our fears, all of our grumbling, all of our hesitations, all our loves, all our joys, all our passions, we give them all to you with our bodies and our minds and our voices. Yours, all yours. For yours is a praise from the unimaginable silence before creation, beyond the farthest reaches of time and space that we may ever find, from infinity to infinity, everlasting to everlasting, you are God, boundless in power and love. But what are we that you should notice us? What are we that you should love us? What are we that you should call us into covenant with yourself, a covenant that we continually break and you continuously sustain. Mercy. How full of mercy are you, loving God? So how can we but praise you? We join our voices with a song of angels and saints, with seraphim and martyrs, with strangers and family in every generation. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. The whole earth is filled with your glory. Amen. Amen. As we come to this place of worship, we come to the Lord's table. I trust that you receive your elements on the way in. And if you did not, just kind of stick your finger up. Someone will hand that to you. We'll ensure that you have some elements you can participate at the table. Just as Jesus gathered with friends that night before his death, he gathered for a meal and he shared the fellowship with them. And at the end of that meal, he transformed that meal into a reminder for them that they would take with them and that we have to take with us, which we do as often as we do it, in memory of Christ. So tonight we invite you to join in celebrating, reaching back those many years ago to that night when Jesus himself was betrayed, and that he invites us to receive of the things that remind us of his great sacrifice for us. Jesus said, when two or three come together, I am there with them. On the night when Jesus was going into death, he had a meal with his friends, and while he was eating, he took the bread, and after he had given thanks for it, he broke it, and he said, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After the supper, he took the cup, and he said, this is the new covenant. It is sealed with my blood. Whenever you drink it, do it in memory of me. So we meet together as friends of Jesus, who have been invited to share this meal. And we remember that the faith that has been passed on to us by those in every generation is passed on by those who have dared to follow Jesus. So we remember too that we belong to a worldwide family, a family of Christians of every kind. And we come from different places with different ideas and different likes and preferences, but we become God's family, the body of Christ. But as we think about that, and we think about God's goodness and his greatness and his love, we begin to be aware that we do not always behave like the members of God's family. Oftentimes, we have not cared about God. Many times, we have not cared about others. And so many times, we have not cared about the world in which we live. So as we prepare to receive of the elements that remind us of what Jesus wanted us to take from that meal, I invite us to look honestly at ourselves in a moment of silent prayer and ask God to forgive us. Let us pray. Loving God, even now we do not know how far we have turned away from you, but we ask you to bring us back. Send your spirit like a strong wind into our lives. Disturb our complacency. Expose our faults. Drive out our pride and our selfishness. And help us put right the things that we have done wrong. Make us willing to forgive those who have wronged or hurt us. Clear away our grudges and bitterness. Demolish the walls that we have built up between us and freshen our lives with your presence and help us to live in love and peace with all people. For Christ's sake, we pray. Amen. When Jesus took bread and wine, he gave new meaning to commonplace things. In the same way, God can transform the everyday things of our lives, the everyday lives of ordinary people. So let us offer ourselves and our gifts to be part of what God will use for God's purposes in the world. I invite you to hold those elements that you have and to raise them as we consecrate them to the Lord. Let us pray. Lord, receive these gifts, harvest of the earth and product of human hands. And we humbly ask that you would accept us with both our strengths and our weaknesses. May all be used to serve and honor you. For your love is greater than we can imagine or deserve. You loved us long before we knew or even loved you. In the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, you show that nothing can destroy your love or separate us from it. You welcome us as Jesus welcomed all who came to him, children and seniors, the lonely and lowly and the powerful, the saints and sinners, the strangers and outcasts, the sick and the healthy, those who were confident and those who searched for truth. So with all of our hearts, we thank you, Lord. Help us to recognize your presence and grow in your love. And by your Spirit, may the bread and wine that we share unite us with Christ and give us life and wholeness. In Jesus' name, amen. Remember the body of Christ broken. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The blood of Jesus Christ was shed because he loved us so much. The cup which we drink is a sharing in the blood of Christ. The gifts of God for the people of God. Please receive of your elements and be thankful.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence, living in me. This is my daily. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me, and I'm desperate for.
As we have eaten, loving God, may this meal be our participation in the body and blood of Christ. Amen. So let us greet one another as sisters and brothers. We might not do it with a physical touch, but maybe with a nod or a wink or a wave. Let us pass the peace and sing the song, "Let There Be Love Shared Among Us."
Oh,
after Jesus had shared the meal with his friends, you would think that would have solidified the bond and made them so close that they would be with him to the very end. But alas, they would leave him one by one. So this part of our service is a service about shadows. And Clive is going to help me to ensure that by the time we're about to read the seventh reading, all of the lights and the Christ candle are going to be extinguished. And then at the end of the service, we'll say a prayer. We will not do a benediction. We will not do any singing, but we will leave into the darkness to contemplate the ways in which our actions might be actions that also forsake and leave Christ on his own. So I invite those persons who are going to read to come in the order and just to share in this time.
Matthew chapter 26, verses 20 to 25. When evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table with the 12. And while they were eating, he said, "Truly, I tell you, one of you will betray me." They were very sad and began to say to him one after the other, "Surely you don't mean me, Lord." Jesus replied, "The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. But woe to that man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born." Then Judas, the one who would betray him, said, "Surely you don't mean me, Rabbi." Jesus answered, "You have said so."
The shadow of the agony of spirit under rest. Matthew chapter 26, verses 36 to 50. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane and said to the disciples, "Sit here while I go and pray over there." And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and he began to be sorrowful and deeply distressed. He said to them, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch with me." He went a little farther and fell on his face and prayed, saying, "O my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping and said to Peter, "What? You could not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." Again, a second time, he went away and prayed, saying, O my Father, if this cup cannot pass away from me unless I drink it, your will be done. And he came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same words. He then came to his disciples and said to them, Are you still sleeping and resting? Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand. And while he was still speaking, behold, Judas, one of the 12, with a great multitude with swords and clubs, came from the chief priests and elders of the people. Now his betrayer had given them a sign, saying, Whomever I kiss, he is the one. Seize him. Immediately he went up to Jesus and said, Greetings, Rabbi, and kissed him. But Jesus said to him, Friend, why have you come? Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and took him.
Shadow of denial, Matthew 26, verses 69 to 75. Peter disowns Jesus. Now Peter was sitting out in the courtyard, and a servant girl came to him. You also were with Jesus of Galilee, she said. But he denied it before them all. I don't know what you're talking about, he said. Then he went out to the gateway, where another servant girl saw him and said to the people there, This fellow was with Jesus of Nazareth. He denied it again with an oath. I don't know the man. After a little while, those standing there went up to Peter and said, Surely you are one of them. Your accent gives you away. Then he began to call down curses and he swore to them, I don't know the man. Immediately, a rooster crowed. Then Peter remembered the word Jesus had spoken. Before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times. And he went outside and wept bitterly.
Enter the world, your glory, there.
Shadow of Accusation, Matthew chapter 27, verses 11 to 14 and 20 to 29. Meanwhile, Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "You have said so," Jesus replied. When he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he gave no answer. Then Pilate asked him, "Don't you hear the testimony they are bringing against you?" But Jesus made no reply, not even to a single charge, to the great amazement of the governor. But the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus executed. "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" asked the governor. "Barabbas," they answered. "What shall I do then with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" Pilate asked. They all answered, "Crucify him." "Why? What crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder, "Crucify him." When Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, but that instead an uproar was starting, he took water and washed his hands in front of the crowd. "I am innocent of this man's blood," he said. "It is your responsibility." All the people answered, "His blood is on us and on our children." Then he released Barabbas to them. But he had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. Then the governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole company of soldiers around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand. Then they knelt in front of him and mocked him. "Hail, King of the Jews," they said.
Matthew 27, verses 31 to 43. After they had mocked him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. As they were going out, they met a man from Cyrene called Simon, and they forced him to carry the cross. They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There they offered Jesus wine to drink, mixed with gall. But after tasting it, he refused to drink it. When they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots. And sitting down, they kept watch over him there. Above his head, they placed the written charge against him: "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Two rebels were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from that cross if you are the Son of God." In the same way, the chief priests and teachers of the law and elders mocked him. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now if he wants him, for he said, 'I am the Son of God.'"
Shadow of Death, Matthew 27, 45 to 54. From noon until 3 in the afternoon, darkness came over all the land. About 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing there heard this, they said, "He's calling Elijah." Immediately, one of them ran and got a sponge. He filled it with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. The rest said, "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to save him." And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, the rocks split, and the tombs broke open. The bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many people.
When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God."
After this final reading, I invite us to spend a moment in quiet. Then I will end with a prayer which will signal the end of the service and for us to leave in silence.
The shadow of burial. Matthew chapter 27, verses 57 to 60. Burial of Jesus. As evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance to the tomb and went away.
Thank you.
Merciful God, thank you for being with us in this wandering moment where we stand poised between life and death, filled to the brim with sorrow, filled with thoughts of what has been and what lies before us. Lord Jesus Christ, we pray that you would set your passion, cross, and death between your judgment and our souls. Grant mercy and grace to us. Grant peace and unity to your church. And grant everlasting life to all who trust in you. Now, people of God, may Jesus Christ, who for our sake became obedient to death, even death on a cross, keep you and strengthen you this night and always. Amen.